Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Thanks for making it out. There's a few people that I want to thank. I want to thank those that came before me on this land, those that came before me in this profession, my ancestors and my family. Of course, specific to this exhibition, I want to thank Shamim for curating me into a show that I'm really quite proud to be a part of. Thank you, Ian, for making this visit really smooth. And Flint and Zach, thanks for hosting. It's always an honor and a privilege to share my work, and I really appreciate you and your attention. I hope that you will make yourselves comfortable. If you need to stretch your legs or if you need to get some water, you know, take care of yourselves, take care of your bodies. Not that this is gonna be like a super long talk. I'm just gonna share four projects with you that I feel there's a lot of connection, but also some disparate things happening, and hopefully you'll see how they kind of weave together my authorship, the material interventions, and themes that I'm interested in, particularly familial and collective histories, glittering and speculative spaces, resistance, celebration, the specific, adornment, and the politics of the living room. So I'm actually gonna start kind of backwards and start with the most recent piece that actually just installed a couple of weeks ago. It opened on like February 8th at Art and Practice in LA, which is an amazing nonprofit space founded by the artist Mark Bradford and other folks. And the show that's up right now is a collection show of works from Eileen Harris Norton collection. And they asked me to create a specific piece kind of incorporating the work of mine that she has, as well as just responding to the space. So this is a photograph within the space. It's about 24 inches tall by like 30 inches wide. It's a photograph, and then it actually becomes like a multimedia piece. So the rhinestones on each nail are actually like glued on after the fact. So it in real life becomes like quite three-dimensional. So obviously, you know, this piece is about Malcolm, but it's also about like my relationship with Malcolm, or you know, varied folks' relationship with Malcolm and this text, and you know, obviously drawing great inspiration from Malcolm. You know, to this day, I recently reread the autobiography, and I recommend everyone, if you haven't, to read that. But also, like, you know, acknowledging that there's some things that maybe he like didn't get perfectly right, but how can you hold space for like a complicated relationship with a history or with a politic or with a figure and a human being? There's also just like these formal things that are so amazing, like that font to me is just like really quite lovely, and just sort of like a book as an object and a holder of you know, where the book has been. So it actually exists in this space. So the gallery, Art and Practice, so the space, whatever you want to call it, exists in Leimert Park, which is a neighborhood in LA that's basically like a Black cultural sort of like city center. So in the way that you know, a lot of towns might have like a little Tokyo, or in LA we have like Little Armenia. There's very few places in the country where there's like a designated zone for like Black cultural production. And so everything happens in this space, from, you know, like concerts, festivals, drum circles. There's a park right across the street from this building that faces the park. And I really wanted to make sure that my piece was speaking not only to the, you know, those inside of the museum, but folks outside of the museum. So you don't actually have to go inside to experience this piece. The text is, you know, facing outward. So this is basically like a window tint, pink window tint on the windows with the text cut out. So it's like a negative space that reveals the text. And then the way that the space functions is inside, it's like this long corridor. And so you can see that the text kind of bounces around depending on where the sun is throughout the space. So the elements in the room, there's like on the right here, a statement and a photograph of a little me. There's a shelf of books, and then in the back by that light is where the Malcolm piece hangs, and there's like a little seating reading area. And there you can see like the Malcolm with the sunlight and shadows kind of moving throughout the space. And so this is the statement, which I'm gonna read briefly for you, or quickly, but hopefully not too quickly. So this like graph paper statement says, part self-portrait and part manifesto, this sparkling library tethers disparate genres and knowledge systems into a constellation of cultural transmissions and collective memory. My own journey with books was not simple or easy. Dyslexic, shy, headstrong, and a perfectionist, I struggled to enter into the mechanics of reading. A school system that was underfunded and overcrowded exacerbated my learning challenges, and I didn't see a place for myself in the world of books. Later in life, I found my own way in. I let go of shame and anxiety and fell in love with literature, history, theory, Toni Morrison, Angela Davis. How do we learn from teachers and institutions and also honor our lived experience and oral traditions to expand what scholarship can be? With this glittering library, I offer the magic and infinite possibilities of language without the regimentation of alphabetical order, the hierarchy of nonfiction versus fiction, but blurring and democratizing the distinctions and allowing chance and intuition to bring a title to you. Feel free to explore. So this is the library. So I basically wrapped each book in these various like glittering holographic reflective papers from like pinks, gold, silvers, iridescents, so that in a way like you can't be intimidated by these books. You can't say like, well, that title is too hard for me, or I haven't read that, or you know, that's not for me. And it really becomes a matter of like intuition, almost like pulling a tarot card, that you just kind of like reach out, grab a book, and see if maybe there's something for you that day. So I know like for a lot of artists and scholars, you know, maybe reading was always something that felt like a refuge for them and felt very safe, but I know for a lot of folks it isn't necessarily that way, and so I hoped that with this piece to kind of you know, take some of the air out of the tires a little bit from thinking of this like, you know, white tower castle where knowledge is like stored away, especially, you know, being on a university campus today, thinking like there's so many different ways to talk about things, right? So even when doing an art talk, you know, sometimes you want to talk about politics, but then you feel like you're forgetting, you know, some of like the art questions, and you talk about art, you feel like you might be neglecting like these spiritual or how we get along together types of questions. And, you know, even like doing this talk in this way is one particular way of doing it. Sometimes I'm like, I should just put on Alice Coltrane and maybe like the same effect would happen. But, you know, using what I can, trying to kind of hold space for all of those different forms. So here's like folks interacting with the library, which it's been really fun to hang out with at the space down there, because it's just a really well-attended you know, space that actually kind of like does serve the community that it's engaged in. So that is to set up some of these projects that I'll go a little more in depth about. So this relates to like the work that you'll see in the gallery. And basically how this all started was that my family filed a Freedom of Information Act request in about 2011 to request from the FBI their surveillance files that they had kept on my father during his time with the Black Panthers and in LA and working with Angela Davis in the Bay Area. It took about almost 5 years of going back and forth with the FBI to actually receive the documents, which was frustrating at the time, but I think everything kind of happens, you know, the way it's supposed to, because when we actually did receive the documents, it was around the time of the 50th anniversary of the Black Panthers. And it seemed to be a moment where people were, you know, once again questioning the role of government and accountability. And the documents were pretty terrifying, invasive, chilling. You know, surveillance kind of sounds like this passive, like, observing of people, but, you know, what's in the documents is harassment, it's intimidation, it's fomenting of personal disputes, it's coercion, provocateurs. It's pretty terrifying, and I kind of walked away with this feeling like, I'm actually really lucky that my dad lived through that time. I'm lucky that he's alive, and I'm lucky that I was born. And it felt like really my inheritance and kind of my, you know, duty to somehow reclaim this information and use it in a way that could empower, you know, my father and his story, and especially the stories of those who weren't as lucky as my dad. You know, there's still political prisoners in jail at this moment, even as we celebrate like the 50th anniversary of the Panthers. We still really haven't, you know, reconciled with, you know, the political prisoners and families that were ripped apart. So basically the task that was in front of me was, how do I turn this information into, you know, works of art? How do I turn it into an engaging and empowering story? And I'll walk you through a few of the ways that I did that. So this is from the exhibition at the Museum of Contemporary Art in San Diego. On the left is my father in like an army uniform. He was drafted and sent to Vietnam at, you know, the tender age of what now to me seems like a child. And then on the right, he's in what we think of as like the, you know, traditional Panther uniform. So kind of thinking of this process of politicization where he, you know, is drafted to war, comes back and realizes that he hasn't earned any rights, any more rights than he had when he left, which is something that you see, you know, after every war in American history, a kind of, you know, generation of black and brown, at that time men, coming home and realizing that, you know, while they've often lost, you know, loved ones and potentially limbs, they haven't actually gained a place, you know, in this society. And so that kind of outrage and disappointment led him to need to do something, and what he felt like was the best thing to do at the time was join the Panthers, who, you know, if you don't know a lot about the Black Panthers, I think one of the best, like, really in-depth texts is Black Against Empire, which really unpacks, you know, the politics behind the sort of, like, iconic facades of, like, the leather jacket and the guns and the berets, but the politics was actually, you know, very intersectional. It was anti-capitalist. It was really about envisioning, you know, new ways of taking care of each other and our communities. So I do encourage, like, you know, a more deep dive into that history. I think it's striking how many things are just, like, the manifesto sounds like it could be written today, or the 10-point platform. The third uniform, it's like too small to see, but he's in a post office uniform, which I'll get into later. And then this is the wallpaper that's comprised of these stamps that I found within the file. So this is just how they looked in the file. There's a lot of, you know, handwritten signatures and dates. You know, the real feat of the FBI and J. Edgar Hoover, who was the director of the FBI at that time, and actually for like 48 years. Which is pretty unprecedented in a democracy to have a figure with that much power in place for so long. He was a totally tyrannical, you know, frightening figure. But it was really this thing of, like, weaponized bureaucracy, and what made the FBI so effective was this kind of, you know, weaponizing of, like, these systems. And so there's just tons of, like, labor and manpower and typist power kind of encapsulated in these stamps. If you see, like, the top right stamp, it says racial insect. And that was just crazy to me, like, you know, this is an actual stamp that is used to designate, like, oh, this is about race. Stamp, stamp, stamp. Like, no, you know, sort of pretending that it was, like, maybe about something else. So this is about 28 pages of the file, which I pulled out for, like, different reasons that I felt could be, you know, communicated. Some of the main, you know, chilling, terrifying things that we found without like reading the entire 500 pages. They're mounted on neon pink plexi. So they get this kind of buzz or sort of like, I don't know, maybe like dystopian future glow around them. They're splashed with pink spray paint and rhinestones, sort of in a kind of like necessarily failing attempt to maybe heal some of the pain and trauma from that time with these like craft store, you know, stickers. And thinking again about like my voice as a daughter, thinking about like caring for my father who's, you know, being criminalized in this way. This page, I don't think you guys can necessarily read the text, but it's like recommending my father's name for the ADEX Category 1, which is basically a list of American citizens who could be rounded up and detained without due process, which is, yes, unconstitutional, but also not unprecedented in this country, if you think about like Japanese internment. J. Edgar Hoover was told by the Attorney General that like you can't keep a list of American citizens that can be rounded up, and so he just changed the name of the list and continued the practice. This is another page that's, it's like really quite simple, but somehow I find it to be really affecting. It's just, it says, Rodney Barnette was observed embarking on American Airlines Flight 474 in the company of Angela Davis. This flight was en route from San Francisco to Chicago. Observations by the SAs of the FBI. This is 1972. This is actually like 11 days after she's been acquitted. And my dad never had any charges against him, yet they're still being, you know, followed at the airport. But to me, this page really functions almost like a photograph in the way that it kind of just like ghostly captures this one really small moment and preserves it. Another thing that I wanted to do was really bring in this element of the family. So this wallpaper is made up of this photograph of my little cousin. She's older than me, but I call her my little cousin because in this photograph, she's obviously like small. And this is referencing like this iconic Huey Newton photograph, which some of you might be familiar with, where he's sitting in one of these like wicker chairs. They're sometimes called like a peacock chair. And he's got like a rifle in one hand and like an African spear in the other hand. And it's, you know, it's a beautiful photograph. It also kind of shows, you know, the how very aware the Panthers were of aesthetics and, you know, using image making to tell a really powerful story. But to me, I'm also always thinking of like, you know, what are the moments behind that iconic photograph? Like there's just kids running around an apartment, you know, family, life is happening. So much of the time I think we separate, you know, this like capital H history from just like family histories. There are so many ways to be involved at that time. And so I'm always trying to bring in this element of the family, of the living room. Another thing that was cited in the files was like my Auntie Bertie, who let her garage be used for Panther meetings. And so now she's like under, you know, surveillance just by sort of like extending your home and kind of the actual radicality of that gesture, even though it's very much like what you do for family. So on top of that wallpaper, there are two graphite pencil drawings, which, you know, since I work in all these different mediums from photography, installation, sculpture, found object, everything kind of has to make a case for itself as being like the way that this piece needs to be. But I felt like this piece absolutely needed to be a drawing. So this is the only image that was in the FBI file. It's this mugshot of my father. And I just rendered it exactly the same as it appeared in the file. So I think because it had been copied and copied so many times, it gets this like almost posterization quality to it, which kind of makes it look even more like maybe this like political, you know, iconography or poster or something like that. And just really thinking about how a mugshot functions, you know, it's necessarily meant to like dehumanize someone and turn them into a number, and thinking of like, you know, this picture on hundreds of FBI desks as somebody who's like expendable and considered dangerous. And maybe through me, you know, replicating it and drawing it, can I somehow turn it into like a portrait of a human and a father and a very specific, you know, loving person. And then this is another pencil drawing taken directly from the file, which is how J. Edgar Hoover was signing the documents, which again, it's just like sort of over, you know, spills over from like this bureaucratic language into the kind of like familial letter writing language. And I'm not gonna like go super in depth into who J. Edgar Hoover, you know, how he, the degree to which he really kind of was even more tyrannical and, you know, authoritarian than you would imagine he would need to be. But I think this sort of sweet signature makes him even more chilling. J. Edgar Hoover famously said that the most dangerous element of the Black Panther Party was the free breakfast program, because he knew that that would really, like, you know, galvanize the hearts and minds of people if they were pointing out, you know, that we needed to be taking better care of each other and that, you know, it's not happening. And the fact that we have, like, free lunches in schools now is because of the Panthers' organizing efforts with the free breakfast programs. It's always interesting to me that, like, that's what he thought was the most dangerous thing. This is a pretty large pencil drawing. The title of the show is Dear 1968, ellipses. And this is kind of just trying to hold space for this conversation. You know, 1968 being just an extremely important year, nationally and internationally. It's the year that my dad is, you know, founds the Compton chapter of the Panthers. It's also just kind of like one of those years that when you say those numbers, it's kind of like this metonym for everything that's happening in and around that time. And then 1984 being the year that I was born, and also like a really significant year for kind of like the beginning of hip hop, not the exact beginning, but like the big beginning or something. You know, like, to me, it's sort of like the 60s really end in 1984. It's like, you know, Reaganomics, it's crack cocaine. It's like really this kind of like, you know, nail in the coffin. Sounds a bit harsh, but it just seems like a kind of like bookend. So it's holding space for this conversation that is maybe, you know, like the year 1968, like, why didn't it work? Or like, what are we supposed to do now? Or maybe it's like an apology, like, sorry, my generation didn't exactly pick it up in the same way. So without really wanting to like distill it into any of those one things, it's just all this like mark making, holding space for that conversation and kind of abstracting it. So you can sort of see at the bottom of like the dark part that it's all like lines of pencil making. And then as well with that exhibition, there's these more like kind of family, maybe like living room salon style hangs comprised of collages like this one, which is actually now here. That's my little cousin Michaela, who is now like 15 and driving, and it's insane. And this is my dad. This is what I call like an in-camera collage. So I basically had this like black and white space printed paper, made it into a tube and pointed the tube at like a pink, neon pink paper, and then put my camera in that tube. And then once I printed out that image, I collaged my dad onto it afterward. But this is really holding space for like this, you know, unsurveillable, unknowable, future liberated space that, you know, kind of exists only in our imagination at this point. So there's like that iconic Huey Newton chair again, this time with like a Hello Kitty cotton candy. That's a floor sculpture. And then here we are to the piece that's here. So this is my Aunt Viv in the photograph. She like sewed the couch cushions and the couch covers, and so she's like, you know, lounging in this like space that she made, you know, with a bit of like you know, pride and obviously like very like stylized outfit with these like flowy satin pants and these kind of slipper shoes. And there's like this photo, you know, painting above the space. It's like a very intentional homemaking space. So I wanted to kind of bring her space to life with this glittering couch, a little television set and the telephone and this wallpaper, which is like these like Afro pic and a little bow tied around it. And then in direct kind of opposition on the other side of the wall are like this wallpaper again of the FBI stamps and two pages from the file blown up quite large. And then you can also see in the space, besides like these family moments and flanking either side of the wallpaper, there's also these like surveillance cameras in the top corner. There's like a detail of them. And so this is really thinking of like a counter surveillance or maybe some type of like spell or magic that I could conjure that would just like turn all the surveillance cameras like, you know, into these glittering, technologies that maybe do something else besides like, encroach on the privacy of citizens. And maybe like somehow the like, you know, love and guidance of my Aunt Viv has like, you know, made like innocuous this state surveillance, or maybe it's, you know, still we're not able to escape it, but it's like this type of like counter surveillance. And so these are two of the pages on the left. It's basically recommending these individuals for the ADEX security list, which I talked about. And those like three pink spray paint stripes are actually how the informants are listed in the document. So like LAT6, LAT7, those are various informants. And you know, really thinking through like this quite complicated relationship with those informants. I mean, what, you know, how are they being used, coerced, you know, intimidated, bribed, what charges were being held over their head to, you know, do what seems like, you know, a pretty painful act of like dismantling the Black Panther Party from the inside out, and not exactly knowing like where to even begin to find the words to talk about that relationship. So using this just like spray painted gesture to hold space for that. And then on the right, it's sort of hard to see in the slide, but like obviously it's on the other side of this wall, are these like really holographic redactions. So the page is already redacted when I receive it, but I just kind of re-redact and add what I'm thinking of as like this restorative technology on top of these names to maybe like retroactively bring some type of peace or dignity to these names, even though they're like, you know, kind of anonymous. And I specifically chose pages that weren't about my father specifically, because this is so many people's fathers and experiences and stories. Okay, so I'm gonna switch gears and talk about this last project, which is in some ways different and in some ways very similar. It's from another chapter in my father's life, quite a few years later, when he owned the first, maybe the last, Black-owned gay bar in San Francisco. So it was called the Eagle Creek Saloon, and this was in the early 90s, like 1990 to 1993. It's something that he's really proud of. Whenever he talks about the bar, his face just kind of lights up. It was something that I always wanted to pay tribute to in my work, and I wasn't exactly sure how to do it, how to approach it. But I got a great opportunity with this art space called The Lab in San Francisco. Dina Beard is an amazing advocate who like runs The Lab and does a lot of fundraising, and we were able to get like a couple grants at the same time. And so it seemed like the best way to like honor the bar was to make an actual bar. So that's what I did. So there's like 12 stools for seating. You can see in the side of the bar, there's like windows with various art objects, more like in line with my, you know, vernacular of displaying objects. There's a like a brass bar and a plexi bar top with photographs underneath it. There's a rack in the back with various objects and photographs and the neon sign on top. And then there's like these little lounge kind of bar seating areas. Here's like a detail of the one of the windows. And that's like one of the photographs under the bar surface. So that's my dad on the right, like the one like holding bunny ears, which I just love because, you know, I feel like sometimes with these like archival projects, you look back and there's like so much reverence and like maybe distance, and like these, you know, archives become like kind of greater than the sum of their parts. But at the same time, it's like people are just people and they're being goofy and they're putting bunny ears on each other and they don't know that, like, you know, 30 years later, their daughter's gonna make a project about it. And then on the left is my Uncle Alvin and my Uncle Carl, who really helped my dad with like the infrastructure of the bar. They like redid the electricity and helped like build out the space, make the bathroom like ADA accessible. And you know, they didn't like identify as queer, but they were just like, hey, this is what Rodney's doing. This is what the family's doing. And so again, like this real sort of familial element and like family as politic is a big part of this. I guess I should, you know, back up and say why my father even felt the need to set up this space. It wasn't because he like always dreamed of having a bar, but it was just because of the racism that him and his friends were experiencing in the white gay bars in San Francisco at that time. So there would be things like folks being asked to present three forms of ID, which was such a like rampant form of discrimination that they actually had to pass a bill saying that you couldn't ask for three forms of ID. You know, and my dad specifically talks about like, you know, one of his friends that was in like an interracial couple, like the white guy would go in first and, you know, it, no ID, oh, come on in. And then like his boyfriend would come in behind him and then he gets asked for three forms of ID. You know, dancing was policed like inequitably. Sometimes like the black music would be taken out of the jukebox. My dad talks about one place where it was like really becoming like a, you know, jam and dance party over the course of like whatever, every Thursday night. And then one day they showed up and all the black music is being taken off of the jukebox. And you know, the way that my dad has also described it is that people were coming, you know, from all over the country and sometimes they were bringing their racism with them. So it was really, an act of like, you know, trying to claim space and dignity for him and his friends. And he had an opportunity to buy a bar. And I also like to mention the guy that owned the bar before my dad was a white guy. And he like really intentionally wanted to sell it to an African-American person. So I thought that was like an interesting kind of, you know, allyship. So he passed it, you know, sold it to my dad. My dad worked there for like 6 months to kind of learn how everything worked. And then it really became like a community center. You know, obviously it was a bar, but it was also a place where, you know, tons of AIDS fundraisers were happening because this is also like 1990. Politicians would come through and campaign. You know, there's all kinds of different fundraisers and people also just like sharing resources and skills and talents. Of course, a lot of the folks who were original members have since passed away. So like this is Sammy in the like black and white shirt in the middle, and then Frank, another regular, both have, you know, have passed away. So it's, there's really a lot of, you know, memorializing in this project as well and thinking about, you know, those lost to the AIDS epidemic. So this is like a, you know, more traditional in my practice, like collage work of, this is Sammy, who was like nicknamed Lady Creek. And I just like love this photo with like the like, you know, press on nails and like all this adorning jewelry and a little bow tie. and like, you know, mixing drinks at the bar. Okay, this is like a time lapse of set of building the bar in the space. And I should say, like, it doesn't look anything like the bar. It's totally just me imagining what the bar, you know, embodied and felt like, and nothing of what it looked like. So we were able to do like a conversation with my dad and some of the former members. It actually was pretty sweet. Like, people just kind of started like jumping up, getting on the mic and telling stories about the bar. Like, it was like, you know, a funeral or something. We did a film screening with the Black Aesthetic Collective, whose work I had really been admiring. Rashad Pridgen did an amazing dance, like, ritual performance in the space. So really it's like became all about the people, which was new for me as far as like an artistic project. You know, I built, when we were like building it in the space, it was like, okay, we're done, it's all together. Like, it's a sculpture and it's a pretty good sculpture. I'm really excited about it. And then the first event that we had as soon as we opened the doors, I was like, it's not a sculpture anymore, it's a bar. And I can't even really explain, I think it was a combination of the space, the lab in San Francisco, which is like this very kind of experimental punk rock space where kind of anything can happen, as well as just like who came and the intention behind the bar, but it felt like a bar. I mean, people were like getting phone numbers, people like came to the second event with people they had met at the first event. It was like so cute. It was like very intergenerational, which I feel like doesn't always happen in queer spaces for, you know, reasons that make sense. Like, it's based on like, you know, where we party, or sometimes like people don't get along so well with their family and you're just like finding folks your own age. But to have like my dad's friends and my friends coming together felt like some kind of combination of like a family reunion, but a bar and kind of like church. And it was just really became like larger than me and larger than an art project. And it was like this crazy combination where I was like, this is like the best art I've ever made, and I kind of want to like tell everybody about it, but I also like don't care if anyone ever knows, because if you're just in this space right now, like that is what it's all about. So I was really blown away with how it all came together. The person who's like bartending in the middle is my friend Redwood Hill, who really is like both bartender and an artist, and so totally understands like this kind of performativity of like bartending, and like was just like really playful with like creating cocktails that kind of made, were like in tribute to various like characters from the bar, and also just kind of like messing with people and engaging with people. And I had like, so like coasters and t-shirts and all kinds of things like in the vernacular of the bar. And I had like these double-sided coasters that I thought was like classier than like the white-backed coasters. But then Red was like, no, like the white ones is how you get phone numbers. And I was like, oh my God, you totally. There was like matchbooks and, you know, just trying to really get into like the language of the bar. So this was like the flyer for when my friend Rashad Pridgen, who their company is called the Global Street Dance Masquerade. And we were talking and it was like, you know, how can we make this not look like a flyer for like an art event, but look like a club, you know, like Rashad Pridgen does like neon pink night at the Eagle Creek. And so I was like, oh yeah, totally. Like, let's make it like more like a party flyer. And so even like the, you know, advertising kind of became an opportunity to work within the vernacular of a bar as opposed to like art. Okay, this video has sound. Hopefully it's not gonna like blast you guys. Thank you. Here we go. Welcome to the new Eagle Creek Saloon. That's my dad, obviously. That's Red.
I'm gonna sing this song for you. Yet I've been so many places, yeah.
That's December, who was one of the original members. Oh, that's like the zine book. I think I forgot to talk about that.
So many things are on my mind. I can tell you something without a doubt. To see you smile.
So this is all like from the first opening night where we kind of did this like conversation with my dad, and then people just like hung out, and there was always dancing like every single time, which I feel like was kind of the mark of like getting outside of like an art feeling, was just like genuine dancing. So that was really fun. Oh, okay, yeah, this is the zine. So bookmaking and zines has been something that's been like a big part of my practice, either like behind the scenes or later as an actual part of my work. And to me, for this project, while like the most exciting thing about it was that it was like a very alive project and in the moment, and not like super, you know, still reverent distance from this like thing that has happened in the past. You know, the bar like installation is very much living, but I did feel like it was important to get the actual history documented in like this little book. Because the thing about the Eagle Creek is that it's not known at all. You know, it's not like in the like queer history documentaries. It's not something that grad students are studying. You know, just like many, many things and names of people and places that we will never know. You know, we don't know all of the people who have contributed to history. But in this particular instance, I really wanted to just kind of make sure that the name isn't like obliterated from history. So I felt like making an actual book with some of the like archival, you know, newspaper clippings and photographs and even like inventory of what was at the bar would maybe like preserve it from disappearing, and that other people would, you know, pick up in whatever way maybe they have like more traditional historicizing skills and could kind of help keep the name alive so that moves around in the world. And then the last thing that seemed like it just had to be done was to take the entire bar and put it on a flatbed truck and drive it through SF Pride last summer, which was also modeled after my father. At the time, you know, the patrons got together and they're like, Rodney, we gotta get afloat. Like, we have this amazing multiracial community, and like, that isn't what Pride looks like. We need to be out there in the streets. And so they like, you know, did beer bust fundraisers. One gentleman sewed all of these like really elaborate costumes. I was like about 5 years old, but I got to ride on the float in this like crazy Victorian costume, and I was just like waving, and I thought I was like the queen of the world. So I knew that we had to do, you know, kind of the same thing. So we, even when we were designing the bar structure, we like designed it to fit on a truck. So I took like all of the objects and the plants and everything so that it would really feel like it did out in the space. And then just invited like everybody who had kind of come together around the project while it was at the lab to come and dance and ride on the float. There we are. There was a babe. There was like from like 8 months old to 80 years old on the float, which was pretty special. That's Sam Vernon, who's also an artist, and Andre Singleton, who is an artist and runs that Very Black Project Instagram account. That's my dad, like grabbing the mic from the DJ and making various speeches, and behind him is Jamal Bates, who is a third of the Black Aesthetic Collective, who did the film screening. So it was really fun to kind of, you know, bring people who had been a part of the project in different ways, like, all onto the float. Okay, then there's, like, this kind of great video, which I'll try to play for you. It's taken, like, from my cell phone on the TV, so the audio isn't great, but I think it...
And we've got more coming. Look at all these. Eagle Creek Saloon. Okay, I'm done. I'm jumping on board that thing.
Get my soul. The float features artwork by Sadie Barnette. Her project reimagines her father's bar, the first Black-owned gay bar in San Francisco, and it was called the Eagle Creek Saloon.
So many fantastic, you know, bars in the city for LGBT community. It's really such a part of our history. I mean, Stonewall, these are gathering spaces for our community. And I wasn't around for the Eagle Creek Saloon, but it looks like it was a hell of a good time.
Yeah. And I think your point is well taken. These are not just bars to drink in, but they're city spaces, places to get information. Right. We meet each other. We, you know, plan parades, basically. So it's important that they continue. When I first moved here, there were 42 gay bars. Now there are about 31 now. I think they're beginning to kind of ameliorate into other things. What's a gay bar anymore, you know? But at that time, it was very important. Yeah.
So I love that because they're like, they really got, you know, the point of it, which was that it's more than a bar. It really is like an epicenter for organizing and community and survival and family. And I also was kind of fascinated by thinking of, like, you know, the, like, Channel 5 news kind of coverage as like a venue for like archiving things. So like, you know, it's exciting to get this into like museum spaces or like publications that I read, but there's something even like really cool about just like, okay, well, once it was on like the news, that's like, you know, however many homes are gonna like hear this name of the Eagle Creek, and now it like really exists in like these disparate various forms of like, you know, where things get like preserved. So it was just like really interesting to me that it made it onto that coverage and that they like, you know, so robustly like understood the project. Then this like fall, the whole project went to the Institute of Contemporary Art in LA. And it was like also really cool there, but definitely is different in a museum space, which is like something that, you know, we can maybe talk about later, like how does the context of a venue kind of shape what's possible for a project? So I learned a lot about that, but it was also like really fun to see it and like photograph it in a kind of like white cube space. And then the last thing that I'm gonna leave you guys with is what I'm working on like right now, which continues this Eagle Creek project. And these are posters that are gonna be on the like bus stop kiosks as a part of the San Francisco Arts Commission project. And the cool thing about it is it will be on Market Street where the actual bar was. So there's like 36 posters, six different posters that repeat six times, which will be up for a couple months. And so the text at the bottom says the new Eagle Creek Saloon was here. It existed on this street. In 1990, my father, Rodney Barnette, opened the new Eagle Creek Saloon to serve a multiracial gay community marginalized by the racist profiling practices of San Francisco's gay bar scene. Located at 1884 Market Street, the bar was a space of celebration and resistance. Sammy was here, and Frank, AKA Lady F, was here, and ancestors whose names we can't recall were here and existed and loved and danced and struggled. The bar closed in 1993, but the legacy of its spirit is embodied in the slogan, a friendly place with a funky bass for every race. And that's, you know, my dad at the time, and he has this like really sweet handwritten note that he actually made recently when we were like thinking about how to talk about the project. And so I don't think you guys can read it, but it says, why Black owned made a difference. To practice our culture, our customs, how we socialized, our heroes, celebrating our history, to be relaxed from white supremacy, recognizing our heroes, sharing our experiences, contributions, and talent, reflect on our own experiences, and then like crossed out because he's just sort of thinking. Here's another example of one of the other posters with like a more, this like archival advertisement from the Bay Area Reporter newspaper, which is advertising this like interactive video game that was like an educational AIDS prevention awareness video game, like kind of like choose your own adventure, like how safe are you gonna be video game that was stationed at my dad's bar at the time. And then this last one, that's like Sammy again, and just this sort of like beautiful formal photograph. I like re-photograph these things in like a light box with like flowers and drink coasters and things, and trying to think about how I could bring this like celebratory memorial feeling that the bar encapsulated into something, you know, more static like a poster. So that should be installed like sometime in the next week or so out on the streets, and then it'll be fun to kind of re-photograph that and see how it interacts with the space on Market Street. So that's what I wanted to share with you guys, and I would love to also, you know, hear if you have questions. I'm totally here for that. But that is basically a lot of sort of fast talking and sharing what I've been up to for like the past couple of years. So thank you for your attention.